Good night, everyone. Tonight with the Gauntlet, we are playing Devil's Dreams, which is a game I've written. My name is Donna. My pronouns are he, him. This is a game set in rural Ireland in the early 20th century, whereby we're all going to be playing villagers. And we're going to be sharing stories about our dreams and see what kind of trouble that gets into. Tonight, I'm going to be playing Joe Driscoll. His pronouns are he, him, who is a young laborer at the local quarry. Joe is known as a quiet man, albeit a bit more sociable once he's warmed up. Maybe that includes a pint of plain. Who knows? Let's get intros from the rest of our players and their characters in character keyboard order. That's you.
Yep, g'day, I'm Blake, he, him. Tonight I'm playing Hannah Byrne, she, her, a young teacher. Went to like teacher school or college in Dublin for a year and then came back. And I figure she's always busy looking after everyone else's kids and generally being the teacher even when she's not teaching.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Brandon. Hi, I'm Brandon. I'm playing Bridget Collins. Bridget is the cook at the Cross Keys Inn, which is the village tavern. My viewer is short, buxom. She has long, coal black hair, enthusiastic, a sweet, low tenor voice. She has had sweethearts, but she hasn't married for whatever reason.
Okay, great. And Horst.
I'm Horst, him. I'm playing William Sullivan. And William Sullivan is the postman of the village and maybe neighboring villages. He's wiry, probably, I'm not sure. He probably taking the bike. Is that an anachronism?
No. I don't think bikes are good.
And I think he's married with no kids.
And David.
Yes. Hi, everyone. I am David, he, him pronouns, and I am playing Dr. Patrick McClanahan. He is the town doctor, a rather rough-looking form of middle-aged. He used to run a small surgery out in farming country, but he is presently, I think, single. I like to think perhaps that he was once married, but his wife passed away during a childbirth that he himself was trying to conduct.
Okay, great. So I guess it's fair to say, right, in a small village, we're all going to know each other, maybe know more about each other than we might like. I guess we'll see how that comes into play. We have a card room with some tarot cards in it. And so what we're going to do in kind of three phases is draw a single card in turn, and then kind of think about the prompt that you get and maybe set the scene of who you're telling the story to about your dream, and then we kind of play through the reaction and maybe play out a little bit of the general thoughts of the characters who are telling or hearing the story before we move on to the next character. So Blake, did you want to draw a first card?
No, I just pull it towards me, do I?
Yeah, so if you click it, it'll flip over and then you can actually just draw it down to your little pawn. And to get the prompt, you can just in the number one major arcana drop down, you can just pull up.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. Or it's under the tab.
The card. Which kind of... Yeah. And then the picture and the prompt should. Yeah, exactly. There you go.
So it doesn't have to be me giving being present. It could be someone I know, but I
don't. Yeah, exactly. So I guess you've had the dream, but it can be about anyone that you want to fill in. So I guess the first thing, I mean, you can just think about that in a while, but maybe, you know, set the scene of how, you know, Hannah is meeting one of us and like how...
Well, we can kind of lead by example, Donna. Yep. So I think she's gossiping with Joe. She had a dream about Bridget having a baby.
Okay, yeah. So where do you think we meet up? Is this like at the crossroads or just outside the school gate?
Or maybe like 4 or 5 in the afternoon outside the school gate. Like, I've kind of finished for the day. You finish your, you know, you've I've bumped into you.
Yeah, so I think Joe is youngish, maybe early to mid-20s. And yeah, he is like dusty and dirty from work at the quarry all day. So probably a bedraggled sight right now. Hannah, how's it going?
The kids were quiet today, but it was good. But I didn't get much rest last night. I had the strangest dream and kind of look around, and it was about Bridget. She was, you know, carrying a little extra.
How do you mean?
You know, she'd met someone and now there's someone else on the way, you know.
Oh, in the family way, you mean?
And she'd go, run along, kids, run along.
And does she have a fella?
I think she's had a few, but you know, that's Do you know she's had a fella? Have you know, been with Bridget? Taking her for a walk?
I've not been taking Bridget Collins for a walk.
Oh, good.
Did you hear something? Do you think this dream, like, has your mind been working overtime, or are you imagining things?
No, I don't think so. She's, I don't know. She seems reinvigorated, full of life, you know, like something's put a spring in her step. And I thought, maybe that's it, you know?
Well, maybe I'll have to go down to the Cross Keys tonight and have a pint and, see what's going on.
Don't be getting too friendly. There's other options around.
There's other options around. Hannah Byrne, what are you saying?
Oh, nothing. I better tidy up here. You have a nice day now. She'll pretend to be busy fussing around the schoolyard.
Okay. And I guess Joe shuffles off, leaving a trail of dust in his wake. Awesome. Do you think we see Hannah like thinking something to herself, or you know, something that she hasn't told Joe about the dream or anything like that?
She might find herself wandering the past Bridget, just to sort of get her eyes on, glance at her, seeing what she's up to.
Yeah, and I think maybe Joe walks past the inn on the way and you know, maybe there's a few people coming in, but I think he's kind of looking back at the school and kind of, you know, shaking his head a little bit at this. I'm not sure how much credit he gives this bit of news. Okay. Cool. Okay. I think, Blake, do you want to add anything more to that, or is that good for you.
No, that's cool. Like, that leaves two of you with something to go with.
Yeah. Brandon, how about you? Do you want to draw a card?
How do I get it?
Oh, yeah. So see where it says Major Arcana, and there's a little downward arrow just to the right of that. Hit the down arrow, and you'll have a drop down.
Everything is okay. Thank you. I think I'll try to double up with this scene, see if it works. I think this takes place with at Patrick's office. And if it suits David, Bridget has come to see you because she has missed her time. And is worried. But she's also wants to tell you something. So perhaps this is sitting in your office after the examination.
Okay.
It's completed. What's your office like?
Well, it's pretty small little surgery that I've put together. There's a kind of a table out in front and a desk off to one side and a cabinet beside that holds one giant book that consists of all of my records and notes. There's a whole bunch of laudanum kind of tucked away in different parts and various kind of old Victorian surgical tools. But, you know, I mean, this is farming country. So aside from the occasional childbirth and amputation, I don't need that much equipment.
You know, Dr. McClanahan, it seems so formal.
Oh, there's no need. You can call me Pat.
You know, Pat, I had the strangest dream last night, and I wanted to tell it to you because I thought you might be able to make some sense of it. I was in the middle of this mob of people who are milling about waiting for something to happen. Knew that something was about to happen in the way that you know about dreams. And then the people one at a time started to notice and turn and look and shout. And there was a man being dragged up the hill. And on the hill was a cross, like on Golgotha, except just one. It reminded me of the descriptions that they say of the trials of some of the saints. Now, not of the crucifixion of our Lord, but this man was dragged up by a braying mob, and most of which were watching, but you know, some were manhandling him and they dragged him up onto the cross, onto the the cross is laid down. They dragged him on there and tied him to it. And then they put it back up there and they left him to hang, but upside down. Crucified him head down. And well, I know that names and faces and dreams don't always mean who they are. That's what I've been told. But my mother always said, never shy away from something that might be a portent. You know, she was perhaps not the best Christian. Certainly my grandmother wasn't. And she believed in visions and portents, things that, Father McGinn doesn't like to hear about. Yeah. And, the figure being turned upside down was you.
It's me, you said.
Well, it looked like you in my dream. That doesn't mean anything. But I just know that I know you've had a lot of difficult times in your life. I don't know the details of them, but it's obvious from your face when you come into the tavern, if it weren't from anything else, that you, things haven't always gone your way. And I don't know, it's a story of the saints allowed themselves to be killed in order to save others, didn't they? To save individuals sometimes, or people, or just to preserve the purity of their faith. They were martyrs. And that's, if I know it's silly nonsense.
I don't see it as nonsense, Ms. Collins.
I'm Bridget, or Bridie, if you like.
Very well, Bridie. I don't see this as nonsense. I've seen a fair peck of trouble in my time, and well, I'll have you know that I have seen a number of cases where I wish I could have put myself in the patient's stead in order to save them and was unable to. And I would be lying to say that that did not in some way disillusion me when it comes to my own faith. So there is quite a parallel between what you describe and my own life, but a portent? I am far too much a man of science to believe in country superstitions.
Maybe by portent then. Well, I guess that makes me ask a question. Was it all the sacrifices you've made, did they do good? Did they, if you looked back, would you make them again?
It's not a matter of the sacrifices that I was able to make. I don't regret those. It's the times when I was unable to help.
Oh, and Bridget's expression softens to you. She says, Pat, you mustn't go there. We all have our ghosts. You know, all of us have things in our past that try to claw at us and take us into their cold embrace. And I don't mean real ghosts and things, apparitions. I mean ghosts of the mind. And all they do is take away happiness from now. And I hate to see that happen to you.
You have a kind heart.
And so now I've put off your answering my question now for as much as I possibly can, and I realize you have other patients waiting.
Naturally. Before you go, though, it will be hard to say until the fifth month exactly whether you are, well, you know, but if it so happens to pass that you are to carry a child, I take care of yourself, please.
Let it not be bad. This is no time and place for a single woman to bring up a child, if ever there was one. I've been a fool. I can only hope that my sins don't come back to me. But thank you.
I'll offer kind of a kind squeeze of your hand, but am unable to offer consolation beyond that as much as I wish to.
She's not crying exactly, but her eyes are moist. No, I'll be fine. When have I not been fine? She says, suddenly brightening up. You come down to the tavern and I'll set you up as always. It'll be good to see you, and you should get out more.
You can count on it.
I'll lay in some of that lamb that you like so much. I've gotten the best tarragon from a few villages over. It's so sweet. Just perfumes the whole dish. Thank you. And chips.
Okay. Yeah, anything else you wanted to add, you know, after Bridget leaves your surgery, David, for Patrick?
I think that he briefly remembers a love letter that his wife wrote him many years ago that he keeps tucked away in a desk drawer. He remembers it, but doesn't have the heart to actually pull it out and look at it.
Bridget, leaving, just crosses herself and mutters a silent prayer.
Okay, cool. Horst, you're up next.
I got the fool. So let's see what that means. The fool, what's the first one? Those who hear your tale think there's no harm in it. No matter how superstitious they might be or how they much they might disapprove of anything.
And the extra bit at the end there is basically if you are the one to draw the devil later on, this basically that having drawn the fool means that the devil will overlook you. So it's a charm against himself.
The adversary. Very good. Very good. Superstition. Help me out in like, we are playing in the Republic of Ireland. Everybody is Catholic, I would assume.
Well, I mean, I guess at this time, right, Ireland as a whole is part of the UK. You know, stay tuned. Things will change in the next few years. And I would say, I guess at the time, probably 80% of the population would be Catholic. And probably more so in a rural part of Cork.
And so. and a lot of the Protestants are up in the north. Mm-hmm. So they in the southern parts of Ireland, Cook and in Cork County, it's much higher, I would imagine.
But I mean, there's a certain Gaelic tradition of, I don't know, fairies and other superstitions that are also part of the belief system, I guess.
Yeah. And so I think, you know, as we might have heard hinted earlier, right, you know, I think most people would in this kind of day and age believe those things, even if it wasn't, you know, part of Catholicism or whatever. You know, you would say not touch a fairy fort because, you know, why would you tempt fate like that, you know? So there's plenty of superstitions around at the time that people would, you know, except for maybe the odd redoubt man of science in the doctor's surgery might hold very closely to.
So to set the scene, I think it will be Mr. Sullivan bringing the mail to, sorry, Blake, your character is Hannah.
Yep.
And what kind of letter would it be?
She's a school teacher, so maybe it's, yeah, no, maybe my brother joined the military or something. He went over to England to work and he's been writing me letters.
So this will be maybe he brings it to school, actually. Maybe it's during the break. The kids are playing outside.
Yep.
And William will, you know, push his bike, lean it against the fence, probably takes his head into his hand and says, Miss Byrne, it is so nice to see you. I do have good news for you, a letter from your brother.
Oh, it's good to see you too. You've been busy, Bill.
Well, I mean, it's not really work, you know. It's good for the health, they say. Dr. McClanahan says that cycling is actually the healthiest profession that you can have. All day.
That thing looks dangerous to me. I'll stick with walking, I think.
Well, is it Mrs. Byrne or Miss Byrne? Out of character.
Miss
Byrne. So, Miss Byrne, you are a learned woman.
I like to think so.
I think I saw a fairy. Is that even possible?
Possible.
I have to admit, it was warm, and I was leaning against a tree, and I might have been falling asleep, but I don't think so. I think he was there, and he was tiptoeing to, it was near Miss Collins' house, and the fairy was tiptoeing and climbing up the roof, and then you know, upsiling into the chimney. Do you think this is possible?
Yeah, I think I do. It's they look after people who are on their own in some sense. Whenever there's a group of people, you don't, you know, you never see or hear about the fairies, but if there's one child off on their own or a person on their own, the fairies will come and have a look because they're curious, a lot like this lot gesturing at the kids. They're youthful spirits. But yeah, I think that's possible.
But I should have listened to my grandma more. But what do they say about the fairies visiting a house? Is it a good thing?
It depends what they do. If they find, you know, that they see themselves as little arbiters of justice sometimes. If someone's doing something bad, they'll pull a trick on them, you know.
Oh, Miss
Cox. If they think someone's nice, they might bring them some berries or some little tasty treats and stuff.
Maybe I should tell Miss Collins to put out some milk for them. Or maybe I'm just foolish. I'm sorry, Miss Burns, to have bothered you.
You haven't bothered me. You're always welcome to pop by and chat. One day, if you want to pop by and, you know, tell the kids what it's like being a postman, that would be good. That'll give them someone new to talk to. And
you can see that Sullivan's face lights up when the teacher talks about the children, and he says, I would love to tell about them, about my occupation. Not that it, you know, that much is happening, but, you know, to show them a little bit how the seriousness of life will be later on. And he chuckles a little bit. Well, you have a beautiful day, Miss Byrne, and I'll be on my way.
Have a good day.
And he will jump on his bike, whistle a jaunty tune, and cycle to the next house.
I think one of the kids will come up and be like, who is that? And she'll turn around and say, oh, don't worry about it, Michael. It's just a grown man believing in fairies. You need to be more focused. You don't want to grow up like that. Let's talk about your writing.
Anything more you want to add to that, Horst, or are you happy with your jaunty cycling tune?
Yes, I'm very happy indeed.
Okay, cool. David.
Yes. Okay. I'll just bring this over, click it. Oh, dear. That would be death.
Not always bad.
Not always bad. Oh, yeah, no, this isn't an automatically negative prompt. A dream of revolution, of freedom from the old ways, affects people in different ways. But when a local luminary dies, what do people say at the wake? Oh, interesting. My first thought is to... My first thought is to interact perhaps with Joe, just because I think you've been in one scene so far. Would you be all right with the prompt that you've suffered some kind of minor injury, nothing terribly debilitating at the quarry. Perhaps you've rolled an ankle or something like that. You'll be on your feet in no time, but I've come by just to examine it, to see if there's anything that needs to be done to reduce swelling and, you know, at least get you patched up. You're not going to be on your feet the rest of the day, but you'll probably be fine in a short while. Is that an okay kind of setup?
Yeah, yeah, that sounds fine to me. Yeah.
Okay. So I think that I'm sort of kneeling at your feet, and there's this kind of imagery of almost kind of like a power imbalance or a penitence sort of imagery where I'm sort of kneeling before you as you sit kind of over me. And I'm examining your ankle. And I'll simply begin by saying that you know, this looks like it's ultimately a fine injury. It'll heal up in no time. You best not put much weight on it in the next day or so, but I think you'll be perfectly able to go about your duties in a few days' time at the absolute longest. You just have to wait and see, I think.
Yeah, I don't know what to do about that. We're busy this weather, Doctor. I suppose I could spare one day of work if I don't go tomorrow.
Well,
but after that, you think I'll be okay?
I should think so. You'll be able to tell, but my concern is that if you push yourself and get back to work tomorrow, necessarily, you'll find that you're liable to re-injure it and actually create a bigger problem than you've already got. So best to play it safe.
Doctor's orders, I suppose. I can accept that. Anything else I should be doing?
I think not. You're already so cooperative. That's the most I can really ask in a patient. You know, it's funny, actually. This reminds me a bit of a something I was dreaming of, actually, early this morning. I woke up and it was raining, which is kind of funny. It's how I can always tell that there's some element of truth to the dream. So long as you're not going to be working the rest of the day, do you mind if I have a chat with you?
Well, I mean, if you're not too busy, you know. Got nothing better to be doing, I suppose. You may as well bend my ear.
I've got a long walk back, and I doubt. So, might as well. You know, I was thinking as I woke up, I was trying to recall the bits and pieces of the dream that still lingered in my fading memory. And it was interesting. I remember that the town itself was enamored in a great funeral. A local man of renown had passed, and while I didn't know his name, I felt some close connection to him. Maybe it was even myself, but I don't know. I'm probably getting that confused with another dream that I heard of recently.
You dreamt own funeral, Doctor. That can't be good.
Well, it's not something to worry about. I've spoken before of how these kinds of portents and superstitions are not terribly frightening to me. The strange thing about it was that there was nary a clergyman at this funeral. There was not a cross to be seen, nor a prayer to be uttered. It was a an utterly godless funeral. And that scares me more than my own death.
You mean like the priest was late, or
you absent?
Were absent entirely.
This man was buried in the ground with not a single prayer uttered.
Hard to imagine. What would a man need to do to be so godforsaken in death?
That's what worries me. This idea that one could be beyond salvation. Or perhaps even that no such thing as even, well, possible.
I mean, you'd want to be a fly on the wall back at the house for the wake, wouldn't you? What would people say about that man if they even showed up?
Indeed. I don't recall what they said about him at the wake, but I recall their faces. There was a grim satisfaction, as if this man's death was in some way necessary. Now, I'm not one who believes in the ideals of martyrdom and throwing one's life away for senseless purposes, but I have certainly wished to be able to offer my own life up in exchange for another's. It's so odd, though, to do so knowing that no salvation awaits, that nothing, no reward lies on the other side. I can think of no grimmer satisfaction than that.
Well, Doctor, sometimes I think, you know, Father McGinn, you know, he denounces things from the pulpit that he mightn't understand. And I wonder, look after your own conscience.
I haven't taken much of what the Father has said to heart in many years. Not since the passing of my wife, but these sorts of things do bring one's conscience to light, and they weigh on one's heart in an anxious kind of manner. I don't know what to make of it, but it does give me some pause. Worries me that perhaps if I were to unexpectedly pass, that, well, some work may yet be undone.
Well, I suppose if you have six people who think well of you, you'll get to your grave, Doctor.
Six people who think well of you. Now that's something to strive for after I had such lofty goals. You raise a fine point, though. I have much to think about on my stroll home.
Okay, well, if you see any more lads from, or Mr. Buckley, more to the point, from the quarry, tell him you've told me I have to stay home.
Of course. You can send them to me if they give you any trouble.
Yeah, and I think maybe as Patrick leaves the Joe's house, you know, Joe kind of maybe picks up yesterday's newspaper and shakes his head and like wondering, like, what is preying on that poor man's conscience that he's dreaming of his own funeral and not being buried in hallowed ground, you know. But maybe not giving it too much thought when he, you know, reads an account of a match, maybe on the back page 5 minutes later. Okay. Anything more you want to add to that, David?
I think there's just a brief shot of Patrick walking down a dirt path with still pools of water from the morning rain. He looks out across these rolling green fields and sees dark gray thunderheads on the horizon and pays observance to the contrast between the two.
Okay, well, I draw the money card, the devil. the money card. The devil has heard your dream and you have gained his attention. He follows you home. Your dreams take on a darker sensual quality. How do you see this affect your behavior? So I think maybe after dark, Joe heads down to the pub, then to the Cross Keys Inn. Because this sitting around doing nothing lark is not for him. And I wonder if I don't know. Do we think that maybe William is there that late? Do we think?
I would imagine that most of the days he goes home early to his wife, but not all the days. If it's, I don't know. Definitely once a week he would go to the pub and have a pint.
Yeah. I mean, maybe this is the next night. So he's had a day off work and he's just sick of They're sitting around, so he goes out the next night. And he's limping a little bit, still kind of favoring his turned ankle. But sits down at his usual spot and maybe sits down next to William if their regular is here, or at least here the odd time.
Joe, what's wrong with your leg?
Oh, bit of an accident yesterday at the quarry. So the doc told me to rest it. So here I am resting it.
Well, beats working, if you ask me.
Well, you get paid no matter what. I get paid for the hours I work.
Well, so, I hope Mr. Buckley pays you good money. And he chuckles because he knows that he doesn't.
Yeah. So I'll have to be there tomorrow morning, first thing, to tug the forelock, you know, and hope I keep getting my shifts.
And William will raise two fingers to Bridget and shouts, a pint for good old Driscoll and another one for me.
You don't have to raise your voice, man. You get the same thing every time you're here. She's already got two pints on a tray and is bringing them your way.
You know, Bridget, I love traditions.
One bit of bitter for each of the fine gentlemen and leave the long faces at home, won't you?
Bridie, we'll surprise you one of these days and take a dram of the good stuff. But
they'll evaporate in the bottle before that happens.
Not if I'm paying, Joel.
As long as you're not one of those, if you're not interested in the northern perversion, by which I mean scotch. Oh, we have a bottle behind the bar for out of towners, but it's good Bushmills and Jamesons for the rest of you that have taste enough to drink whiskey. Anyway, I'll leave you two gentlemen alone. As alone as you can be here.
So tell us, William, what scandal over there? I've heard a couple of things the last few days that have really turned me. I can't put head or tail to it, that something that's going on with our doctor and something's going on with Bridie. And
Bridie?
Yeah.
I mean, the good doctor, he's a very serious man, don't you think?
Well, I would be too if I had had his luck.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
He put a fright into me yesterday. He came up to look at my ankle, and then he said, I need to talk to you about something serious. And then he told me that he had had a dream of his own funeral, except he wasn't buried in a churchyard.
He was William is crossing himself.
He was just buried, like, I don't know, at the crossroads, like something out of a tale.
Like a heathen? Heathen?
A heathen, yeah. You know, and I, Bridie, what's going on?
Oh, Bridie overhears you just out of the corner of her ear. Okay. And she goes, or a suicide. And she passes on to serve somebody else.
Exactly. But
what?
And you know what they say about people who get buried at the crossroads, that the devil comes to take them. And that was in my head all day. I couldn't move. He told me to rest, and I slept poorly on it. I had these terrible dreams of, like, I don't know, one of those gargoyles or something that you see in those, the books Father McGinn used to show us when we were young about hell, damnation, and all that.
Joe, you're worrying me. You shouldn't talk about these things.
I'm worrying you. I'm worrying myself.
Well, I'm here to take the worry from you. And he, you know, cheers with the clinking the glass, I guess.
Yeah.
So, what do you think it means?
What do I think it means? I mean, you know, we should keep an eye out for the doctor so he doesn't commit suicide.
He doesn't. I mean, he's a serious man, but he doesn't strike me as someone who's desperate.
Well, he lost his wife. I don't know how you'd be.
I don't know. I mean, me and Margaret, we tried so long for a child. And at some point, you, I guess, get used to it. And I can imagine, I mean, I do have Margaret and the good doctor. Well, bless her soul, his poor wife. But I don't think that he's desperate. I think he strikes me as someone who feels fulfillment in his work.
Well, that's fair, William, I suppose. Like I said, I'm probably just imagining things.
Joe, you really shouldn't say the name of the adversary out loud. I mean, that's what Father McGinn said.
What's he going to do? Come and knock on my door and bring me to court for using his name in vain? I don't think so.
Stop it, Joe. It's bad enough that you dreamt of him. There's no reason to tempt him. And he crosses himself again. Apparently, William is a superstitious man.
Okay. So, I'm kind of happy with that. I think, though, based on the prompt, we'll have to maybe paint the scene a little bit of Joe walking home a couple of hours later, maybe a little bit unsteady, but that's obviously all down to his ankle. And you know, in the distance, maybe behind him, we see a dark figure. You know, follow him down the road and kind of stand outside the house as he turns in for the night.
Did you want to have a break, or are you?
Yeah. I think now is a good time to have a break. So I've got 21 minutes past. Do we want to break till 9:30? So 9-10 minutes. Okay, so we're back and ready for round two. Blake, draw another card and see what we get.
The star. Okay, so I just pull that down. I might just see comes in a dream. I don't know, maybe. Oh, okay, now I've got to see who I'm talking to, don't I? Maybe Dr. McClanahan, maybe it's I'm headed to work and he's headed to his work, and I bump into him in the morning.
Yeah, if that works for me, I'll have my doctor's bag with me and we'll have a little bit more downcast face than I normally would on my way to work.
And I'm distracted by my dream, so I pretty much bump into you. Sorry. I've got my head full of wool this morning.
Oh, no, that's perfectly fine. You seem a bit distracted, but I can understand that, certainly. Is everything okay?
For me, I'm okay.
Seem to be in a bit of a hurry.
I had a very strange dream, and I couldn't get my ducks in a row this morning. Everything was, kept dropping things and bumping things around the house, but what was the name of the mine owner?
Mr. Bucky.
Mr. Bucky. Okay. Yeah, I had a strange dream about Mr. Bucky. He went up to Dublin and lost a lot of money gambling. He thought, you know, he was on a winner because everyone's working so hard for him, and he got into debt and lost a lot of money. He got beaten up. Couldn't pay his debts.
Gambling debts caught up with him.
I barely know the man. I don't know why I dreamed about him, but he was quite vivid. He was full of himself and lashing out with the money, getting the girls. You know how some men are in the big city, and got away from him and got beaten up.
That's one of the strangest things I've ever heard. Dreaming about people you hardly know. Well, must be nice having money to gamble away in the first place.
I'm not implying anything, Doctor. I've got a few savings, but I don't. I can't go gambling. I'm a school teacher.
Of course. Well, that is interesting. I suppose one can get kind of overambitious when they come into a certain amount of power, whether it's monetary, professional, spiritual. There's all manner of means by which one could become rather arrogant and overcome with their own ability, only to be smited at the last minute. I'm sorry, I'm getting a bit too heady for this time of morning.
Chill, straighten your tie, and well, sorry for bumping in you again, Doctor. Have a good day.
Oh, you as well. And if there's nothing else, I think that I will have a expression of sort of anxious contemplation about my face as I stroll off.
I think Hannah will kind of look back and is like, was he implying that I know too much for my own good or something, and I'm being judgmental? Did he sort of insult me, but not? Okay.
Anything more you want to add to those observations? No? Okay. Brandon, you're up next.
The High Priestess.
Let's see. I guess let me think. I will who would be the most receptive to a very kind of allegorical dream?
I would volunteer, but I think we've had a scene together already, so I'll offer offer other people priority.
I mean, William is very superstitious, so he will see portents and omens and all kinds of symbolism.
Okay. So I think this is at the tavern, and William is dropping off the mail some people get their mail at the tavern. Mm-hmm. You know, it's because their houses are too far off the beaten track to deliver, so that we just hold them there. I mean, rather than, because they always drop in there and they don't always drop in the post office, and it's just an informal arrangement. And there's a few people who live above the tavern, and Bridget's one of them.
Yeah, I think William will take a handful of letters.
Yeah, the owner and his wife, and so far unnamed owner and his wife do as well. In fact, he might not be married. I think he's a widower and an older man. And she goes, do you have time to stop a moment, William?
Of course, Bridget. Can you maybe
a bit of lunch?
Yeah, well, liquid lunch, obviously.
We have food here too. You know, I could make you a sandwich or nice potato hash.
It's a beautiful day. I wouldn't mind a cycle a bit lightheaded.
All right, well, half a pint then, so you won't fall off your bike. She brings it down and she punks it on your table and then sits down with you. She says, I've got a lot on my mind and it's, bringing me the strangest dreams. I usually sleep like a stone, and I don't remember what I dreamed. But last night I had, well, I don't know what it means. And I was thinking, maybe somebody might be able to tell me. So, as long as Father McGinn doesn't care about it, he'll tell me all these dreams, that dreams come from the devil. But how can this one come from the devil? But I dreamed I was all in this beautiful land. Green, but but the lush green, like you hear of jungles in Africa, with fruit from all the trees, and every good thing to eat, and it was water in a clear flowing brook, like Ireland, but with more food and a better climate and better government. And no one else, except then a man came in, and he sat with me, and I realized this was my husband, in the way you realize dreams. And I said to him, look, I found this fruit that we've never tried before. And he said, oh, I've never seen that. And I said, well, it must be very special. Won't you share it with me? And I had a bite, and I gave it to him. And it was the most delicious thing I'd ever had in my life. And he had some too. And for a moment there, I felt as close to him as close can be. Just we two happy in this wonderful place. And then I felt so sad, as if knowing it was all going to end. And I've learned not to put too much of a faith in the faces you see in dreams. But I daren't say whose face I saw.
Which one?
I don't know. Well, he's here in the village. And he's a good fellow. But what does it mean? I mean, I'm not so thick as to not know where it could be. But they have is what we did so bad. It's all that. Or do I misunderstand it altogether?
Do you go to the mass on Sunday?
Of course I do. What do you take me for?
Well, maybe you should talk to Father again.
About dreams? Your life.
Well, but your dream comes from the good book.
It's blasphemy to imagine myself as as Eve or anyone. I don't know how he'd react. And the last thing I want is for him to grill me about my sins.
Well, there's power in dreams.
There is too. But I mean, I don't want it to reflect badly on Joe. I mean, the fellow in my dream. Sure, and he is. Could be anyone. But I don't want to leave. This is the only home I've ever known.
Why would you leave?
Shame, of course. You know how it is, a small village. People talk, and there's no getting away from it. I know better than most. I hear the talk. Do you remember, back 10 years or so ago, when Seamus Murphy was found out for stealing?
And I remember.
No one had anything to say about him after that, except, that Murphy, that's it. The Murphys, they're thieves. You can't trust Murphy. Seamus is a bad seed. You know, keep your Kim, lock up your daughters when these are out and your belongings. They hounded them right out of town. You know? And sure, he shouldn't have done it. Should he have been punished for it for the rest of his life by exile? Who knows what's happened to him? Here he's gone to live in Dublin, far away from anyone who ever knew him. And hope he's found something there. But it's a crying shame.
People can be terrible, but you know, the Lord will forgive you.
Well, the Lord may forgive me. Will anybody else? And she starts to cry and then wipes her tears almost immediately with the bar rag. Oh, and I've said too much. And you see she's been drinking.
I tell you, Bridget, that my lips are sealed. And whatever you told me, and I don't know what you told me, is buried with me. But you need to think about your soul as well. Maybe you should see the Father.
Can't. Just can't. I am. If only he'd look at me. You know, if only he'd say something. Well, it might be different. I know he doesn't care. But you would feel better. Oh, I kept you long enough. And sure, it's a fine day outside. You should get back in it. It's going to rain in the afternoon.
And William sighs and gets up and stretches himself and says, well, Bridget, if you need to talk to someone other than the father, you will always have my ear for what wisdom I can give you. And he chuckles again.
Thank you, Bill. Sure, and there's someone I'd like to talk to about it, but he won't talk to me. He'll hardly look at me. And there's the problem. But if there's a problem, it's mine to bear. And she realized what she said and burst out laughing.
I think William is too slow to put one and one together at the moment, at least.
And she leaves you to your rounds.
Yeah, I think William will jump on his bike, maybe with a, I don't know, slightly somber face, thinking about what he heard.
Okay. I guess we get to follow up with a dream immediately from William. In that case,
true. The Wheel of Fortune. I think William as the Fool at the Wheel of Fortune. He's a lucky man. Let's see, what does it mean? Wheel of Fortune. The dream promises sudden change, but who in the village is struck by fair luck or misfortune in the coming days and who's responsible? So let's see with whom the scene is. It's either the good doctor or Joe. And now I had a scene with Joe already. So it is Patrick McClanahan. Would Patrick McClanahan go to church?
He goes more out of a desire to fit in than anything. I think that since this died, he's lost much of his faith, but it's a small town and
people would talk.
Exactly. It's just part of decorum to attend. So that's a sensible thing that you could find Patrick doing.
And after church, what would he do? Go straight home or mingle with the people in the churchyard or go to the pub?
I think he might find himself at the pub.
So it's a Sunday after church. Somebody in the village. I don't want to pile on Bridget's misfortune.
You'll find me if you want.
I don't have a problem with it if you, you know.
No, you can say me if you want. I don't go to church. I'm generally tidying up the school then, so.
The coming days and who's responsible. I want to say it's Bridget, actually. There will be a dream about her. I think is Patrick sitting in a corner, standing at the bar? Do you have like your own like spot where you normally sit?
I think I have a table that I go to, and I think on Sundays I, perhaps as reinforcement for attending and sitting through church, I treat myself to a particularly nice lunch. So I have a, you know, a pint of some nicer stout, and you know, perhaps that lamb that Bridget mentioned in an earlier scene, all ready to go. It's the good tarragon on it.
So I think William will stand at the bar and wait for the doctor to finish his meal. And then walk over with, you know, standing respectfully like a feet away and clearing his throat. Well, Dr. McClanahan, so good to see you.
Is everything quite all right? You seem a bit alarmed. Well, but please, won't you sit down?
Thank you. I'm not alarmed. It seems that people have their minds on grave things. Maybe I'm the only one who has light dreams.
Oh, no. No, I think just about everyone does sometimes.
Well, I had a dream last night. And it started with a tree. And the tree was full of blackbirds. And, you know, I didn't think anything of it. But then more and more blackbirds flew towards the tree and until there was no spot left. And so I went closer and closer. And I saw someone up the tree. And I can't say if the birds protected her or closed her in. And they were all, it was these brooks or ravens cawing and how do you call that, Doctor? You are man of many words. Is it a conspiracy of ravens?
I'm familiar with a murder of crows.
Maybe it was a murder of crows then. And I don't know. And he looks over to Bridget. I don't know who that woman was. But I don't know. I think it was Miss Collins.
Mm.
Do you think there's any meaning in dreams, or is it just our mind wandering?
They're a bit like a pool of still water. You look into it and can see a reflection of yourself, but it is clouded and sometimes difficult to decipher. But that does not make it unreal, necessarily. There is still some to be learned from close examination of these phenomena.
My grandma always said that what happens in your dream is not something that has happened necessarily. And I had the feeling that it will happen. Is that weird?
Plenty of folks seem to think that dreams are portentous, but I think they are less a description of what will happen than as a description of what is going on within you at this moment. What is it about Bridget that's caught your eye, Mr. Sullivan?
Oh, I worry sometimes about her. But I don't know, it's not that I heard anything.
Go on, you can say it.
I just think that maybe being the owner of a tavern is not the most appropriate occupation for a single woman. The temptations of, I mean, if I would, if I'd work in a pub, I'd probably be drunk all day. And he laughs on.
No, I think Bridget is quite capable of handling her own matters, don't you?
Yes, of course. I don't want to gossip or anything. It's just what I dreamt. And lately these dreams have been so strange, so vivid.
You know, traditionally, crows and ravens and birds of that type are thought of as a sign of impending doom. Do you have any worries about the well-being of Miss Collins, or perhaps of yourself? Sometimes nerves can reveal themselves through these kinds of dreams.
I don't know. I think Bridges is a very good woman, a very good woman indeed. And I just want to see her happy. You're talking about impending doom does not lighten my heart. No.
I only reflect what I hear back to you. You tell me dreams of crows and such, and there are only so many ways one can interpret that. But if you care so deeply for her, perhaps she is the one to talk to. If there is something going on with her that you are worried about, no. She is an intelligent young woman. She'll appreciate your reaching out.
We had a lovely talk just the day. I'm not a learned man. And whatever I could tell her about my dreams, I don't think would help her either.
Well, you needn't reveal them. I only mean to say that there are some who might feel quite, shall we say, at odds with the world, some who feel as if fate has conspired against them. Well, matter of fact, you did just say conspiracy of ravens, didn't you?
I did. Are you one of these men who think that fate has treated them badly? Excuse me, I should have been so forthcoming.
No, there's no need. I wonder that myself. It's, I don't know. But I certainly wonder. I don't know. You needn't worry about me, though.
Well, Dr. McKellen, if you would come over to my house, I promise Margaret will make you a dinner that might rival the very good food that Miss Collins provides.
No. Don't tell her that.
I wouldn't. And I think, William gets up and shows some kind of respect, I don't know, a nod to the doctor and then goes over to the bar.
Okay. I guess we can switch to Patrick then.
Okay. Let's see here. The tower.
Oof.
I was going to say, I'm getting some dramatic ones. Right. What's the prompt here?
Oh, dear. The tower is much worse than death.
Yes. Yeah. This is catastrophic. What ruin is foretold in the dream? When it arrives, what is the extent of the misery caused? And was it due to some great adversity or negligence?
As a suggestion, it could be the mine.
Could be the what?
The mine.
Oh, the mine could come to some great ruin.
Yes, yeah. Yes. Not everything has to be evaporated.
No, we'll just do the third Screw Bridget scene in a row. No, that's fine.
Bridget is, I think we know what's happening.
It's
a question of how quickly and how suddenly.
Well, we'll spread the misery out, I think. Maybe we'll have a discussion with, you know, I've already, my last scene, I set it up with Joe, but, you know, he being the quarryman. Well, I don't know who I should be talking to about this kind of thing. I think Joe seems sensible if we're talking about the mine, but...
Well, there have to be a couple of repeats, because we're going to have...
Mathematically.
I've more scenes than connections.
Right. Well, in that case, if you don't mind, Joe, we'll just double up with you.
Yeah, sure. So maybe does it make sense that... You know, maybe it's the next day or something, or a few days later, and you know, Joe is maybe passing you in the street, and you know, just gives you the old clear on his ankle, right? Get to chatting about something.
Mm. I think that the thing that stands out to you here is that Patrick, while he is typically a well-spoken and scholarly sort of man, he appears quite withdrawn. Quite distressed, and most of all, quite drunk. Something is very wrong with him.
And is this like early in the day?
I think it might actually be perhaps in the, I'm thinking maybe kind of towards the dead of night. I wonder if there might be some reason why Joe might be out and about after nightfall, if there is kind of a social meeting that he'd attends, or if he was coming home from the pub. But I'm thinking that this might be a nighttime scene where the stars are hanging overhead in kind of a lurid, portentous kind of way, or something like that.
He might have had a house call. He might have been called to somebody's home to attend to them and be returning from that.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I think that might be a good reason for Patrick to be out and about. Joe, what about you?
Yeah, I think Joe maybe is just out and about for no obvious reason, you know, given that the devil is following him around, and maybe in his dreams, you know, maybe being out at night seems like a sensible course of action to him.
Mm. And I think as you pass Patrick in the street, he's muttering to himself something along the lines of, oh, it's just your imagination, there's nothing to it, this is all, it's just the nerves getting to you, everything's perfectly all right, it's just stress, you need to put your feet up, go home, have another bit of whiskey or a spot of something.
Doctor, are you okay? You seem a little bit worse for wear.
Mr. Joe Driscoll, how's the ankle, my boy? How are you?
Yeah, it's grand. It's been coping with the work No problem.
Fabulous, fabulous. My prediction was quite right then, I say, bracing myself against you, and you get this blast of whiskey breath off of me.
You've been down at the pub, Dr.
No, my own personal reserve, Mr. Driscoll.
I thought the stench was finer stuff than we get down at the Keys.
Yes, special occasion, one might say. I say a bit gravely.
What's the special occasion?
Oh, I made the mistake of taking a nap this evening, and now I'm going to be utterly unable to sleep nor turn my brain off. Not without another bit of, well, something. You see, during this nap of mine, I was awoken by a roaring sound. The sound of collapse and clamor of breaking stones and utter calamity, the likes of which I've never heard in real life, but within the deepest recesses of my own heart, I have known all too intimately. Joe, is everything quite all right at that mine of yours?
Well, you know, we're taking stuff out of the ground. I will say, though, you know, between you and me, no one else is here. Mr. Buckley seems a bit shot. Like he came back a couple of weeks ago with, he looked like he'd been in a bit of a tussle.
Oh, you know, I've been thinking about Mr. Buckley now and again, and some folks I have heard fall prone to their own arrogance, and it can lead to a downfall both internally and of their livelihood. Joe, you're not digging too deeply.
Oh, where
are you?
We're going at it hell for leather. Pat, I tell you, it's like there's been a change come over Mr. Buckley since he came back from Dublin. He seems eager to make a quick profit. No more caution like he was wont to do in the past. No, it's hell for leather, like I said.
Joe, and I kind of look at you with this crazed alarm in my eyes. Joe, I have learned this evening the dangers of delving too deeply, both into one's own soul and into one's own ambition, and I would not have you be the victim, the martyr who pays the price that Buckley seeks to pay. You must understand, I am a little bit drunk.
A little?
Just a bit, not more than, more, I'm sorry, what were we talking about, Mr. Driscoll?
How badly you're going to feel in the morning.
Yes, perhaps I need to take to my abode and nurse my troubles away. But with all sincerity, Mr. Driscoll, I am worried for you.
Well, sure, if anything happens, you'll patch me up.
There are some wounds that even the strongest medicine in this world cannot heal, Mr. Driscoll. Mind you that.
Okay, well, let's see you home. Make sure you don't, like, walk off a bridge or anything.
You always were the self-sacrificing type, I say, allowing you to kind of guide me home. And beyond that point, there's not much intelligible that I can say as I become utterly swept away in my own mind.
Okay. Yeah, so I think I'm happy to leave it at that. I think it's Let me draw a card, see what is my follow-up strength.
Strength.
I think we'll lean into Patrick's dream pretty full on. There's a collapse at the mine, and I think Joe is like dragged out with a few more after a few days. And he is a bit I think he's not in any kind of serious danger after, but you know, maybe a little bit delirious, and maybe someone needs to take care of him for a few days. Who do you think might be at his bedside when he starts talking about his dream?
It's Bridget, of course it is.
Okay.
You don't know it, but you're in one of the you're in a guest room upstairs at the tavern. Because that's when Bridget can keep an eye on you when she's, you know, during whenever she's got a spare moment.
I think in one of Joe's more lucid moments.
She's rinsing. She's, you know, rolling a bandage, you know, or rinsing out a dressing. When you start talking.
Righty. Do you ever feel like you're bearing the weight of the world on your shoulders? I felt that then in the mine when the collapse started.
Oh my gosh, you needn't talk. Don't waste your strength. Save it for getting better. You were a near thing that you almost died. But the doctor says you'll be well. She suddenly rushes. She suddenly puts down everything, rushes over. Okay. Will you have a drink of water then?
I will.
Okay. Sit you up. Okay. And it's good to hear you talk. You've been going in and out.
I'm trying to remember. There was someone down there with me when I started to dig my way out. Someone with soft hands who held me and told me I needed to get out.
Sure, and it must have been the Virgin herself, because there was no one down there with you. There are a few others trapped, but all in their own place.
But they felt familiar, like someone who has been around. I can't explain it.
Do you go on the talking to me? Do you good?
They just spurred me on with a few pats on my arm, a few soft words, gave me the strength to to dig myself out to the main shaft
I heard it were a near run thing if they hadn't heard you. Hadn't heard you crying out so loud. No, they would have never found you. They started digging in the wrong place.
There was such a stench down there. Sulfur. I still smell it on my hands.
Yeah. They dug a little too close to the... Dug a little too far down then, Joseph Driscoll.
Well, that's where Mr. Buckley told us to go. I had one eye on the exit, though.
Yeah. You focus on getting well. There's not a few here in the village who would miss you if you were gone. She says, who will miss you when you are gone? Would miss you if you were gone.
Well, someone was looking out for me down there. The Blessed Virgin or the devil, I don't know which.
No. Never speak the adversary's name. Don't you know he's always listening? Well, who knows? Perhaps the one who saved you is just a poor sinner like yourself, set with her own problems. None of your making.
So I think that's everything from Joe. Do we like get a sense of what Bridget is thinking after that, or are those words from her kind of her state of mind?
Oh yeah, no, Bridget turns away from Joe and goes back to rolling his bandages, and she is tears are running down her cheeks, but she's making not a sound. She's looking after him, but she can't bear to tell him what's happened. Because, I mean, you know, he was in no place to make an honest woman out of her in the first place. And now he's hurt and may not work again. It would just burden his soul to tell him. So she can't, and she's too afraid to do it.
Okay. Do we want to take another break, maybe 5 minutes or so? Does that sound?
Yeah, cool.
Okay. So we're back and into chapter 3. Blake, we're back in.
Magician. Those who he what a painting. Right.
What?
I think I've talked to everybody. This. No, I haven't talked to Bridget, have I?
No, you haven't, actually.
Okay.
But with 15 scenes, you know, we'll have you know, 5 repeats in connections, because there's only 10 possible connections if my math is right. So, but yes, you haven't spoken to me, so you might.
Okay. I think I'll go to the pub for dinner, which is sort of a weekly thing for me, and chat with Bridget.
Hannah. Hello.
Yeah, hi. It's good to see you. And you notice her kind of studying your face when she's talking to you. How are you? You okay?
Good? Oh, you know, this and that. We have roast beef. We have have a treat, chicken with dates?
I'm starving, so whatever you can give me as quickly as possible.
Well, the roast is done, so we'll just take a nice slice off of that and some greens, some potatoes.
Sounds good. Listen, we've talked a few times. It was like me when I'm older, and it reminded me a lot of my aunt. She lived her whole life being busy doing stuff for other people, but, you know, no marriage, no children, no one to greet her at the end of the day when she came home from work or whatever. Is that going to be me? Am I already too far down that path? Am I done for? Am I too late? Should I go to the city again or something? What?
Too late. Listen to you. Too late, and you're younger than me. You could pick up your traces and go start a whole new life. Find yourself a husband, settle down, have children, do whatever you want. There's many a, if the village doesn't, life doesn't suit you, there's many a job to be had in Dublin. Respectable occupations for a single young lady, being a secretary or manner of thing. Everything, you know, things new every year, I hear.
My grandma used to say, you know, everyone's got to live their own life, but I'm like, I'm just teaching other people's kids. Am I living my life, or am I just helping everybody else, sort of thing?
Sure, and isn't helping other people living a life, but only if you want to. But you should listen to me. Dreams are telling you something, sometimes about yourself, sometimes about someone else, right? And tell me about the dream. What happened?
Sometimes it was like me, and sometimes it was like my auntie, and it was when I was older and similar path. No husband, no children, running around traveling with other people. And I felt in the dream I was taken for granted, and I sort of was sitting there towards the end in a rocking chair, and no one noticed me. It's like my life was not fulfilled.
Seems clear enough to me. I remember a story. I don't know if it's true, but I've heard tell that an admirer of my great-grandmother brought her over a rocking chair that he had made with his own hands. Beautiful thing. So the story goes. It's not a family heirloom, because she threw him out on his ear and threw the chair after him. Broke into a dozen pieces.
She chuckled.
She said, "You'll not catch me in one of these things, young man. If this is your idea of damning me or my future, then to hell with you." She was a profane old woman. That part's true enough. So now, if you're dreaming of a rocking chair and it's not a good feeling, throw that chair out. Get going before time catches up with you. That's what I hear your dreams say.
Anyway, look,
you've got a place to go, and you've got a future. Not everyone can say as much.
Well, I thought I had some options, but it seems that they've turned into options for other people, and she'll give you a strange look, and I better go. And she'll wander off.
All right. Oof. Judgment.
Inevitable, huh?
Well, it is inevitable, but not, yeah, it, you know.
No, I would say she's upset because she was hoping to bring Joe around, but she feels like Joe's wandered off to Bridget. So she's like, well, my hopes for that's gone down the toilet. Maybe I should leave town or something.
Joe's a heartbreaker. Not necessarily that he intends to be. Okay. So when it says the meeting is just one of the dream meetings.
Yeah, yeah. So I guess the conversation where you were relating your dream. So this is more about kind of the in real life repercussions of this, and maybe less to do with the dream itself. But we can always mix it up as you prefer.
All right. Let's see. So this could be with anyone, although it'd be rather different if it's with Joe than if it's with I think it makes most sense to be at the doctor's again.
But the priest has to overhear it, is that right? So it can't be like totally private.
Well, this says the priest saw the meeting. So this implies that this scene includes the priests having acted or said something like that. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's up for interpretation. I would say, you know, maybe, I guess the follow-on is that, you know, maybe someone has broken a confidence, or maybe he's always had his misgivings. So, you know, there's room for him to intuit something, even if he doesn't overhear it. Yeah. So
maybe the priest and some churchgoers are looking at Bridget as she goes to the doctors, and like they're looking judgmentally and gossiping and stuff.
Maybe you can already see the child, that she's with child.
Okay, well, here, I'll throw this open. Who wants to find Bridget just crying her eyes out?
Is this too obvious for Joe to find her, or do you think it would be nice to mix it up?
It's not too obvious.
Okay. So yeah, I think maybe
this is in a back room at the tavern, like in the, you know, the storeroom or something like that, where she has Bridget just suddenly absented herself from the, I mean, you know, she does a lot of the cooking, so she does this, but she's She's notably absent. During a busy time, and if somebody asking her would be told, oh, she's in the back somewhere.
Yeah, and yeah, I think Joe for some reason or other feels like he needs to go seek her out instead of just sit down and wait for her to emerge from that storeroom. So yeah. The door opens a crack and he kind of peeks in.
She is sitting with her back turned. Well, you know, it sort of halfway, you know, turned to the door, halfway away. And she has her head in her hands and is visibly weeping.
Bridie, what's the matter?
Who's that?
It's Joe.
Oh, Joe. This is nothing for you to see.
What do you mean? What's happened?
Go on and leave me with my shame.
Your shame?
Sure, and you must be the only one in the village who hasn't heard it.
What are people
Father,
saying about you?
Father McGinn heard it from Evie Stalton and from others, I'm sure, and has already took me to task for it, so there's no need to come and lecture me.
Well, Father McGinn can, I won't say what he can do to himself.
Who gives a shite
what he thinks?
Plenty enough, and do. You'll not have me to trouble yourselves with after Sunday. I can't leave old Bertram in the lurch from the busy weekend, but then I'll be gone. Sure, and I won't be able to show my face in church. It's bad enough having eyes on me. Here, at least I can make my excuses and sit in the back. I don't have to be out, but it's got so I can't go down. I've had to send little Ivy down to the market to buy things for all the looks I get. The door is slammed in your face.
You're no thief like Seamus Murphy. What is it you've done that's so terrible?
Joe. I've not had the courage to tell you. Because I know the news wouldn't do you a bit of good.
Well, my life is a bed of roses without this bad news, obviously.
No, that's the point. Well, Joe. I'm with child. The story's well out, and it's true. I had hopes that it was false, but Bill Sullivan's confirmed it. I'm with child, and my life is here, is over. There's no.
Why would you not tell me about this before?
Sure, and what could you do about it? So what? I can't ask you to take this burden from me. You're in no position to support a family.
And people worse off than me seem to handle it.
But everyone, the stain would be on your name from the conception out of wedlock. Even if you could, and who knows, they say you might not work again, Joe, or you might only be able to take odd jobs here and there.
So what are you saying? You'd be better off by yourself. Is that what you're saying?
No, you'd be better off.
Ah, well.
By myself. And the whole damn village. And I can't, Joe, I can't stay here. They'll never stop talking about this. Not in my day, not in my child's day. They're going to look at him or her and say, bastard. I'll not have them make that name. I'll sooner go to the city and make up some fictional father who died. And maybe not everyone will believe me, but at least it's possible.
So, when are you going? Sunday or Monday?
First train Monday.
Okay, well, I'll come
Monday,
back.
Monday, the tavern's closed. Oh, I'm pretty much packed.
Okay. I mean myself. I'll pack a bag for myself.
No. And what would you do? You've got a place here. Your friends are here. Your family is here. Everyone you know is here.
But, you know, you've already said I'm useless, so...
You'll find something.
I'll scrounge to get her a fare. It's a public train. You can't stop me.
Joe, I can't stop you, but I'm telling you not to. For God's sake, Joe, make a better life than what I can give you. I know you don't love me. Don't do this from duty.
Do you? You know what's in my heart, do you?
It was just you and I. We had both had a few, and it was good, but it wasn't a promise. I'll not exact you one from you because of the consequences. Don't do it, Joe. My life is ruined. Yours doesn't have to be.
So, yeah, I think we see Joe leave the pub. Do you want to like add some details for them again, or kind of general reception to that, to the drama?
Yeah, no. There are a few people at the pub. You know, they call you over and they josh you, you know, about things. Nobody knows exactly, you know, you hear from them about, the rumors that Bridget's in the family way, and nobody knows who the father is, but if he's smart, he's fled, he won't say a word. Probably it's mostly kind of, lighthearted stuff. But maybe somebody comes down all moral and judgmental and says, a crying shame that a fine establishment like this has to be, has to have a fallen woman. In it, and he would, the publican should should have second thoughts about who he takes into his employ. So, you know, but who could have known she seemed like such a nice girl? Well, it's the ones that seem nice you have to watch for. I think Joe gets an earful of that.
Okay. Horst, how about William?
William gets the Emperor. That sounds fancy. Let's have a look. The Emperor. The dream hints at some decision, future or past, of an authority figure. Jeez. Does it hint at some secret or surprising motivation? Well, there are two authority figures in the village, which is the priest and Mr. Buckley. Future or past? It might hint at some secret or surprising motivation. Mm. Oh, I mean, unless our good teacher is an authority figure for the small folk, at least.
Maybe in the dream I was teaching them about different forms of government, like, you know, this new fangled socialism thing or democracy and monarchy.
I could imagine it might be about your decision to leave the village. I'm not sure if you have made the decision.
I've talked to a few people about it.
So I think the scene is William in front of the class with his bike and a bag full of letters, explaining how the distribution of letters work to the children. And he has the kids, you know, sit on the bike and he jokes around. And then he says, but you also have a lot of free time because, you know, what if it's noon and the work is done, all the letters have been distributed, and you can just sit under a tree and close your eyes and have the nicest dream that you can imagine. In fact, I tell you about a dream I had just the other day. So I was seeing a woman, and she stood at a crossroad. And to the left, it was our grand old village. Sure, it's a bit boring, but you know, all your daddies and mummies live here. But this woman, she stood at the crossroad and looked at our swell village. And then she looked to the right, and on the horizon, the sun just came up, what is it called, the sunrise. And the woman stood there, and he looks over to Miss Byrne. The woman stood there just like your teacher. And then she didn't turn left, she turned right towards the sun. Isn't that a beautiful dream?
I think Panda's eyes are boring into you at this point. and she'll say, well, you know, as you grow older, just like riding a bike, you are there will be decisions in your life, and they can change whether you want to be, whether you want to like stay a male man, or whether you want to become something else, or if you were something else before. And you'll have to decide that based on what you want to do. But also children, you know, things are affected by what other people do. If the king of Ireland or the leader of Ireland, or, you know, whoever it is above us, it sits in government, says we have to go to war, then we have to go to war. It's a decision made for us. And you have to think about big decisions as you go through life. Does anyone have any questions for William? And they probably ask about where can I get a bike from? Can I have another ride? That sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm. And William is especially caring and funny and light-minded when he's around the children that he and his wife never had.
Yeah, that's probably good.
All right, does that bring it over my way?
Yeah, I think it's it's David, so.
Okay. Justice. See the prompt for that. The dream shows a desire for a balanced decision, but has the deserving triumphed in front of the law, or has there been an unjust ruling? Interesting. I'm wondering. What has become of Buckley at this point?
I don't know. With a mine in collapse, do we think he can't get the money out fast enough to pay his debts, or maybe there's some legal recourse for the accident? I don't know.
At this juncture in history, legal recourse for the accident is on behalf of miners is not going to happen.
Yeah.
No one's taking the miner's case, and the government's not going to bring a case against a miner.
Unless the mine went bankrupt or something, but
yeah,
maybe, I mean, you have a dream creditors, about you buying it.
Creditors might sue him. If people thought if he had investors that thought he mismanaged the mine, they might sue. And that could take him to court for sure.
At the least, perhaps we might say that at this point in the story, Buckley has suffered a very significant financial blow himself as a result of the mine collapse, but also perhaps most of the miners and by extension the town's economy have suffered a substantial blow. So there is a significant degree of economic nervousness about the town, and the questions have to be raised and decisions made regarding what people are going to do going forward. Are we leaving? Are we going to try to stay and make do, despite the fact that much of our livelihoods are gone and unlikely to return anytime soon? Is that maybe an okay kind of setup for this particular scene?
It sounds like a good one. If maybe a judge has condemned the mine as being unsafe, and so even though people want to reopen it, but it's they can't. It's the court is tied
about it. Town meeting or something.
Yeah.
Sure. It could have been a decision arrived at in theory democratically. Well, I'm interested to see who I might speak to about this kind of matter. I'm kind of inclined to go towards your character, like Hannah, perhaps, just because I don't know that we've spoken recently. Alternatively, I think William might be good too, because he's sort of just the messenger, and
he's a government employee, right? So however,
I may have been helping out with the books, the mathematics side of accounting and the books with the mine, because not everyone's educated.
That works too. We'll go with that then. Where might I find Hannah?
Yeah, I'll be in the schoolroom, but I'm doing the mines, checking through the mines books, trying to look for, you know, what are our resources, what are our liabilities, and accounting fun.
Certainly. I think that I'll stroll in through the door, and I'm carrying with me a small sort of a bushel basket with various kind of fruits and little confections, and nothing terribly fancy, but it's nice enough and is clearly a token of goodwill. It's a nice gesture. I'll approach Hannah and I'll place the basket aside you as you do your work.
Thank you, Doctor.
Of course. It is a token of goodwill. And after all of the laborious work you have done to bring the matter regarding Buckley's mine to a close.
Well, it affects a lot of people, that, you know, affects the kids. They've been a bit rowdy since their parents are restless as well. It all flows on through all of us.
Yes, we're all very restless, and all kind of take a seat sort of at a desk and look around and maybe just kind of begin fiddling with a loose piece of chalk or something as I just try to make myself vulnerable and comfortable enough to start talking.
Yeah.
You know, the...
Come on. Yep, speak.
Well, I was just thinking that this decision carries grand implications for the future of this town, and many people don't know where they'll go, what they'll do, will they stay, will they not? And I have great worry for the future of the people here in the town, more broadly speaking. What do you think the ultimate outcome of all of this is likely to be?
I don't know. There's a lot of assets. They did have a lot of equipment. They had a lot of tunnel digging. The mine looks profitable. It's just the way it was run was dangerous. The management of it was the liability, not the resources or the staff or the equipment. So I think it is worth persisting with.
It's a shame that all of this had to come down on the heads of the workers and by extension their families. I was dreaming of something to this effect not long ago. It was shortly after the decision was handed down. It was a strange kind of imagery, very brief, just a flash, but it left a really remarkable impression upon me. In short, the image of a sacrificial lamb of sorts. Nothing religious necessarily, but, well, perhaps it was. It was this great image of a crime having been committed, and an old judge from times gone past, centuries ago, medieval almost. And so as not to too greatly disrupt the order of the town, hands down an order of execution upon a scapegoat who must perish for the sins of a crime that they did not commit.
I don't like that at all. That is not fair, that is not right. We should be better than that. It's insert year here, you know, you should have learned from all the mistakes from the rulers of the past and the empires of the past. We can do better than that. We are learned, well, some of us are learned people now, you know, we can do better. That's what I try and teach the kids anyway.
I wonder though, if we will not all find ourselves in one way or another condemned, if not by our own behaviors, then by the actions of others. I don't mean to be terribly gloomy. You do good work. I just can't help but imagine that there is a fell omen that has fallen across the town.
I think some look at... we're talking about, you know, looks around the classroom. And look, we're talking about the weather the other day. Lots of clouds. Oh, no, it's cold and windy. Everyone runs inside, but the rain comes down on the crops. My point is, it depends how you look at it. When I look at these books, I see the mine is worth persisting with. The town is, and by extension, the town is worth persisting with. We can learn from what's happened, sure, and we should, but this isn't the death knell. This should be, let's think about what we're doing and approach it more cautiously.
I think that I'll smile inwardly and say, you always were a logical woman. It's good to have someone like you around here when so many of us are prone to falling into despair. I appreciate your thoughts. And I'll set the chalk down and take my leave.
Thank you for the gift, Doctor.
Oh, of course. It's the least I could do.
Yeah, should go back to the books.
Is that it from your point of view, David? Yeah, okay, cool. So I've drawn the lovers for the last card.
How appropriate.
Sense of humor.
There's an inevitability to these things.
Yeah. And I think when I guess we pick up on Joe, it's like Monday morning or whatever, and he is walking kind of out of the village towards the railway station. And I mean, I think there's something about him that is different. He doesn't look back at his home or the kind of mine that we can see in the distance, or at least the spoils from the mine. You know, and he's not walking with Bridget or anything like that. He's just like walking to the train by himself, albeit the train that she has told him she'll be on. And then, you know, he takes a seat on the train, and I wonder if Bridget will speak with him or sit down next to him, or will he be talking to someone else, if that makes sense.
Yeah, Bridget. Bridget will come and she'll sit next to him. You know, they're in, you know, second class. But first, you know, this train's not full. Because this is just kind of a little sidelined, and you know, it'll fill up when it gets to the next major town. It's just, yeah. There's a morning train and evening train to a town our size. So right now there's some empty seats. And she sits down beside him. She's in her best clothes, which is, you know, nothing fine. But, you know, it's her, you know, church going clothes, because she doesn't have anything else that's really presentable in public. And she has a little carpet bag. So it probably has all the belongings she has and owns in the world. And she goes, Sure, and it's a fine mess you've got yourself in, Joseph Collins.
Well, like you say, no one knows us in Dublin. We can tell them whatever story we want.
We can tell them whatever story we want.
And they'll believe us.
Well, Joseph Collins, I don't know what plans you have or how you imagine things might go, but I have a few things to say.
Well, you spoke your mind the other day.
What on earth could have drove you to make such a foolish decision? This is a prompt for your dream.
And last night I was tossing and turning, and in the middle of the night, I thought to myself, well, the only thing more foolish than going to Dublin with a girl would be not going to Dublin with a girl. And I said, what have I got to lose? There's nothing for me back there. And truth be told, I was thinking of what you so eloquently called a one-off mistake, or whatever words you used, but well, who knows?
So, is this just a thought you had? This is a prompt for a dream.
Well, I mean, it did occur to me, tossing and turning, that why shouldn't we do these things? Why should we be bound by the rules that the village, the magnates who have us under their thumb, should impose upon us? Why shouldn't we do what's best for us without regard for Father McGinn or Mr. Buckley or whoever thinks they're taking care of us by keeping us in our place? You're muted, Brandon.
She pauses a good bit, and she says, I have a few things to say for you, Joseph Collins. First off, you're a damn fool. Second off, I'll not live in sin with you. If you have it in your mind to go through with this bit of insanity, well then, we'll have it properly solemnized. Or we'll not do it at all.
Seems like a fair bargain to me. Damned fool that I am.
And third is, God bless you for the brave soul that you are.
Well,
I never wanted to tell you. And I never wanted you to know.
I mean, I'm sure, with the shame of it,
and I felt it was all mine.
I'm sure even I would have figured it out sooner or later. You know.
Oh, I'd hope you, when you figured it out, I'd be long gone. And you could have shrugged and gone on. What? Well, you've put your foot in the bucket along with me. So we'll just have to make the best of it, shan't we? She says, and she has a little smile, and she takes your hand. And a little bit of the old Bridget comes out. That lovely, you know, girl of boundless enthusiasm, happiness that drew you in the first place.
Okay, perfect. So I think that's all of our scenes. Now we have a quick chance to do like a very brief epilogue for people if they want to kind of show their characters in the future and how this has played out for them. I don't know if Blake, you want to go first with that?
Yeah, I think Hannah will stay, and she'll sort of be like part-time administrator, emphasis on the admin part of that, of the mine, doing the books and stuff, and probably have regular dinners like twice a week or something with the doctor, and just want to talk to another sort of level-headed person and kind of subtly get him to ease back on the drinking. She needs someone of a level head around town, sort of thing. And it gets her out of the, you know, I'm dealing with kids all day, sort of thing. So she finds a bit of purpose in her life being a rock and a structure for the town.
Okay. Brandon, do you want to add anything else for Bridget?
We see Bridget with her in the kitchen with a child, with a toddler crawling around on the floor, and her kind of nudging it out of the way of the fire with one leg, and she says, "No, you keep." No, Sean, you keep to one side there. I'm laying down the sandwiches to sell at the market. You don't want any of them to spill on the floor. And it says your papa's going to come home, and I'm going to have to give him all my attention. So. Don't you get in my way now. Not enough hours in a day, she says. And then she smiles to herself.
Horst, how about you?
I think we have a juxtaposition maybe from the lively scene with a small child and Bridget to a very quiet Sullivan home, and William and his wife sit just silently at the table, with maybe the ticking of the clock in the background.
Awesome. David, about the good doctor.
I think that he has finished his work for the day, and he goes to sit at his desk, and you can see that rather than one giant book full of documents and patient records, he's had to add a second one, because so much time has passed, and he's seen and done so much work. And he closes up his book for the day, and it's night out, and he has nothing but an single oil lamp going to illuminate things. And I think he is about to go and turn in for the evening. But before he does so, he will simply open the desk drawer, pull out a bunch of papers, set them aside, and find that letter from his wife. And he will take a moment to read it before he puts it away and turns the light off.
And for Joe, I think we see him in a pub, and he is finishing off a measure of whiskey, and he tells a couple of lads that he has to get home to his wife. And, you know, he puts on his hat and his coat and walks out, and I think we have a glimpse of him, like, walking down the alley or the small street to their house or their hovel, I'm not sure. And I think we get like a playback of that silhouette that we saw following Joe back that first night we saw him after his dream. Okay, so that's it. I'm gonna stop recording and we do a quick debrief. Thanks very much.